I got sent to Washington, D.C. years ago when I first got my job, and the first assignment I got was to go talk to Senator Sanders. And I walked into the room, and it's like the event in Indiana Jones when Indy's walking into Sean Connery's office. That's what it felt like. There's books everywhere. And I was extremely nervous, and I said, Mr. Sanders, my name's Ty Dragoo. I'm with United Transportation Union.
Oh, you're Ty Dragoo with UTU. I'm with you.
And I said, Senator Sanders, my boss gave me a bunch of stuff I'm supposed to go over with you. And he says, I am with you. Well, I had 45 minutes, and I knew I had to talk about this stuff. And he finally said to me, and this is the moment I fell in love with Bernie Sanders. He looked up from all these papers and he says, well, I guess we could spend time talking about our families. That's true. And we spent about 30 minutes talking about our families. I'll never forget it. And with that, I am proud, I am honored to introduce Senator Bernie Sanders to the state of Kansas.
Thank you. A lot of people here. All right. I was apparently incorrectly told that Kansas was a Republican state. I don't see that. Well, if it is a Republican state today, you're going to change that tomorrow, right? Well, for all of you who have seats, do you have seats over there? Sit, sorry. I talk for a long time. You don't want to stand up. Jane and I are honored that you invited us to be with you here in Kansas. And my understanding is between this room and the overflow room, we have some 5,000 people out tonight. That's pretty good. And I think this turnout speaks to the reality that more and more Americans are becoming increasingly concerned about what's happening in Washington today and are prepared to stand up and fight back in Kansas, Vermont, and all over this country. So thank you all very much for coming out tonight. And let me thank the Kansas Democratic Party and the many, many volunteers who helped make this event possible. And if I can, I also want to take this opportunity to personally thank all of you, or those of you, who supported my candidacy for president. I think it's fair to say that we surprised a few people here in Kansas. And with your help, we won a great victory here, and I thank you very much for that. As I think many of you know, during the presidential primary, taking on almost the entire Democratic establishment and calling for what I will call for tonight, a political revolution, we ended up winning 22 states, including Kansas. We won over 13 million votes, 46% of the popular vote. And most importantly, and I think where we together have had a lasting impact on the future of this country in every state. We won often by large margins the votes of young people under 40 years of age. We won the under 40 vote of African Americans, of whites, of Latinos, of Asian Americans, of Native Americans. And why that is extremely important, and we should make no mistake about it, is that our vision, our progressive vision, is not only the future of the Democratic Party, it is the future of America. Tonight I want to make a few points to those of you who are here, and I also want to make a point, if I might, through the media, to those who are not here, the Republicans in the state of Vermont. And I know, and I'm more than aware, that Donald Trump won a very significant victory here, and I want to talk about Trump's campaign and why he appealed to so many people, not only here in Kansas, but obviously all over this country. But as I begin, I want to make a point, maybe the most important point that I'll make this evening. And that is that I hope that nobody in this room, nobody in this state, nobody in this country fails to understand that we today in America are living in the wealthiest country in the history of the world. We are not a poor country. If we were a poor country, the nature of our discussion would be a very different one. If we were a poor country, then people would say, well, look, we would like to have health care for all. We would like to have the best education in the world. We would like to have an infrastructure which was strong, but we can't do that because we are a poor country. We don't have the wealth. So please, whenever you hear anybody on television or any of the political leaders telling you, we've got to cut this, we can't do this for our kids, we can't do that for the elderly, we don't have the money, tell them they are not telling the truth. And let me also say, I know that a lot of folks here in your state, in my state, all over this country, they are discouraged, not only with what's going on in this country, they're discouraged with how our democracy is working. And in my view, democracy is a beautiful system, and it is not a complicated system. What it is about is honest people respecting each other's point of view come together and they say, all right, these are the problems that we face. How do we go forward in addressing those problems? That's democracy. It is not more complicated than that. So I want to take a few moments to tell you what I believe are some of the most serious problems facing this country. And sadly, and too often, many of those problems are not openly discussed. You're not going to see them on the TV. You're not going to see governors and senators and congresspeople talking about those problems. So let me lay it out to you as honestly and straightforwardly as I can. For a start, we need to understand why, for the last 40 years, under Democratic administrations and under Republican administrations, we have seen a middle class in this country shrink and shrink and shrink. Now, what does that mean? It means that there are millions of workers today in America, in Vermont and in Kansas, who today, in real inflation accounted for dollars, are earning less than they did 30 or 40 years ago. It means that in America today, millions of people are working longer hours for lower wages. It means that in my state, and I am sure in your state, we have people who are working not one job, they're working two jobs, they're working three jobs in order to cobble together income and health care they need to take care of their families. And we have got to ask ourselves why. There has been an explosion of technology. Technology is good. Workers are more productive. Why is it that literally 100 years ago, workers were out on the street marching and demanding a 40-hour work week, and today millions of workers still don't have a 40-hour work week? They're working 50 or 60 hours. When we talk about why the middle class is declining, it has a lot to do with the fact that we have seen millions of good-paying jobs leave this country because of disastrous trade policies, where corporations say, why do I want to pay a worker in Kansas $15-$20 an hour? I can go to a low-wage country and exploit the people there, destroy their environment, and pay them a few dollars an hour. And we are telling those corporations today, those days are over. Invest in America. And when we talk about the decline of the middle class, it has everything to do with the fact that either wages are going down compared to inflation, or they are stagnant at the same time as the cost of health care goes up, the cost of housing goes up, the cost of education goes up, the cost of prescription drugs are rising. When we talk about the decline of the middle class, and many people don't understand this, that today, as I speak before you, there are people in Kansas and millions of people across this country who are one paycheck away from financial disaster. Their family life is destroyed. They go into bankruptcy. They lose their homes if somebody in their family comes down with a serious illness and they run up a high hospital bill. There are people today who are scared to death that their 10-year-old, 15-year-old car may break down and they can't get to work. And if they can't get to work, they don't have a paycheck. And then their family is going to be in very serious shape. And there are millions of women who have been impacted by a divorce, which have set them back financially, forcing them to figure out a way to take care of their kids. Now, it is up and on and on. There are two realities economically, as I see it in this country. One, Democrats talk about a whole lot and should talk about, and that is there is no debate among honest economists that today we are an economy which is far, far better off than it was when Bush left office. Thank you, President Obama. And that is a simple reality, a simple truth that is hard for any honest person to deny. We have created millions of private sector jobs. We have seen some increase in wages. Our deficit has gone down. That is just a fact. But there is another reality that we don't talk about enough, that Democrats don't talk about enough. And that is while the economy today is better than it was 8 years ago, when Bush left office, we have to acknowledge that many, many people in this country have been left behind, that many, many people in this country are in deep pain and they are hurting. We cannot address those issues unless we acknowledge that reality, and it is a reality. It was a very great honor to be able to run for President of the United States, and in that capacity, I visited almost every state in this country, and I met just incredible people. I left the campaign being far more optimistic about the future of this country than when I began, because I saw so much beauty out there, and I talked to so many fantastic people. But in talking to people, real people, and I wasn't busy going off to fancy fundraising events, you know, I was going to those communities where people are often hurting, and I will never forget, you know, being in Washington, D.C., where my day job is, you know, and marching in a demonstration with a guy who works for a government contractor, and the guy makes $11 an hour, which in Washington, D.C. is not a living wage, and he's homeless. This guy was homeless working for a contractor of the United States government. I will never forget being in Detroit, Michigan, talking to young people, in this case, African-American young people. They were working at McDonald's and other fast food places, making all of $7.25 an hour, couldn't even get 40 hours a week. They were getting 20 hours a week, going to another place and another place. I've talked to single mothers in this country who are making decent wages, making a decent income, earning $30,000, $40,000 a year, but they have little kids. And do you know how much it costs to provide decent quality childcare for a little kid? $10,000, $15,000 a year, is that right? Now, how in God's name does a working mom who's doing okay, making $40,000 a year, pay $10,000 or $15,000 for one kid and almost double that for two kids on childcare? You can't. And yet every psychologist in the world, and all of us, understand that the most important years of a human being's life, of our intellectual and emotional development, is 0 through 4. And yet, millions of families all over this country, in Vermont, in Kansas, all over this country, are unable to find affordable, quality childcare. How absurd is that? Traveling all over this country, I have talked to teachers, and God bless the teachers. And I have talked to teachers in public schools who literally are taking money out of their own paychecks in order to buy the supplies that their children need. Talk to children who live in areas where there isn't decent quality broadband so that they could do their homework in an effective way. And talk to teachers who see kids who are hungry coming into their classrooms for whom a hot lunch is the only good meal they're going to get in a day. This is the wealthiest country in the history of the world, and no, we should not be having the highest rate of childhood poverty of almost any major country on earth. And as I went around this country, I had the opportunity to talk to beautiful young kids who do well in school, but have given up the dream of going to college because their families lack the money. Think about that. Think about kids who do well in school, who want to make it into the middle class, and they can't afford to go to college because their families lack the money. And I also had the opportunity to visit with many young people who did go to college, did go to graduate school, did go to medical school, dental school, and they have left school $50,000 in debt, $200,000 in debt. We have a major dental crisis in this country. Very hard for people to get affordable dental care. We need more dentists. Never forget talking to a young woman in Iowa, graduating dental school, $400,000 in debt. And people are paying off their debt decade after decade. How absurd is that? I have talked to older workers, workers who are 55, 60 years of age, workers who have been employed every day of their life, but are now scared to death about what faces them in retirement because they have no money in the bank. It's not widely known, but almost half of older workers in this country have zero savings as they prepare for retirement. And earlier this evening, I had the opportunity to meet with workers again, people who worked their entire lives, often in union shops, who were promised pensions, and those pensions were taken away from them. And if those workers could stand up, I would appreciate it. Are they here? There they are. Okay, thank you very much. And these guys are not giving up. They're going to fight and continue to fight, and we're going to work with them to make sure they get the pensions that they were promised. And when we talk about honestly what's going on in this country, let me tell you that I have talked to many physicians in my state and throughout this country who tell me about the patients they lost, patients who died because they didn't get to the doctor when they should have. And the doctor says to these patients, why didn't you come in earlier when your symptoms first arose? And they say to the doctor, I didn't have any health insurance, or I had a deductible that was so high I just couldn't afford to come in. And some of those patients do not make it. And what you should know is we lose tens of thousands of Americans every single year because they do not have insurance or their deductibles are too high. And that is why we are working overtime to tell my Republican colleagues, you are not going to repeal the Affordable Care Act. Now, if my Republican colleagues want to make improvements in the Affordable Care Act, that's great, because it does need improvements. But to simply say to 20 million Americans, we're throwing you out on the street, and we're sorry that some of you will die or suffer, will become much sicker than you otherwise would have become. To say once again to people who have quote-unquote pre-existing conditions, people who have cancer, have diabetes, have heart disease, that you once again are going to have to go into an insurance company who will tell you, sorry, we can't make enough money out of you, you're too sick, we're not going to give you any insurance. We are not going back to those days. And I have talked to seniors all over this country who today, despite the Affordable Care Act, still cannot afford the prescription drugs that they need. There are seniors in America, many, many thousands of them, who are cutting those pills in half, which is obviously a bad thing to do, but they just can't afford the outrageous prices that the pharmaceutical industry is charging us. And our message to the pharmaceutical industry, stop ripping off the American people. Stop charging Americans by far the highest prices in the world for the same exact drugs that are sold in Canada, France, or the UK. The last statistics that I have seen is that while one out of five Americans under 65 are unable to afford the medicine their doctors prescribe, at the same time, the five largest drug companies made $50 billion in profit. And that's just some of what's happening in America. That is a reality. Bottom line is that we have a middle class which is disappearing. We have 43 million Americans living in poverty, while at the same time, we are seeing the very wealthiest people in this country becoming ever more wealthy. And brothers and sisters, that is an issue we are going to have to deal with. It's an issue that the media and many politicians are just not comfortable dealing with, but it has to be dealt with from an economic point of view and from a moral point of view. We have got to ask ourselves, what does it mean when over the last 35 years, we have seen a massive transfer of wealth? You know, Republicans get very nervous when you talk about redistribution of wealth. But the truth is that over the last 35 years, there has been a massive redistribution of wealth, but it's gone the wrong way. It's gone from the middle class to the top 0.1%. We have got to ask ourselves morally, what does it mean when the top 0.1% now owns almost as much wealth as the bottom 90%? What does it mean when the 20 wealthiest Americans now own as much wealth as the bottom half of America, 150 million people? What does it mean when one family, the Walton family of Walmart, one family owns more wealth than the bottom 40% of the American people? What does it mean in our country that while so many of our people are struggling to keep their heads above water economically, in the last 17 years, we have seen the number of billionaires in this country increase by tenfold. People on top doing phenomenally well, middle class in decline. But it is not only a grossly inequitable distribution of wealth that we are looking at, it is also a very unfair distribution of income. Since the year 2009, 52% of all new income has gone to the top 1%. So in Vermont and in Kansas, you got dad working, mom working, the kids are working. People are working incredibly hard, incredibly long hours. 52% of all new income goes to the top 1%. This is what we mean when we talk about a rigged economy. And our job together, and it's not going to be easy, but our job together is to end that rigged economy and create an American economy that works for all, not just the 1%. But it is not just the economy that is rigged. What worries me very, very much is that our political system, our democracy, is also increasingly becoming rigged. You know, democracy is not a difficult concept. What it means is one person, one vote. You get a vote, you get a vote, you get a vote, majority wins. That's called democracy. But because of the disastrous 5-4 Supreme Court decision on Citizens United, good, you know what Citizens United is. And what that means is that your friends in Kansas, the Koch brothers, okay, I guess they're not your friends. But they now have the capability, and are doing it, of spending hundreds and hundreds of millions of dollars to elect candidates who will represent the wealthy and their friends. Now, our job together is to overturn Citizens United. And our job, in my view, is to move toward public funding of elections. But it is not just a corrupt campaign finance system that we have to deal with. There's something even more insidious. And that is, we have Republican governors all across this country who are trying and working overtime, trying to suppress the vote. You know, and as somebody who has been involved in many elections, you know, I take this one kind of personally for this reason. You know, when I run for office in Vermont, we work really hard, and we know what areas of the state are going to vote for me, what areas of the state are not going to vote for me. Not rocket science, we know it. But it has never occurred to me, and I think never occurred to most honest politicians, that you got to figure out a way to make it harder to prevent people from voting who will vote against you. That is cowardly. And I say to those Republican governors and Republican legislators, if you don't have the guts and the ability to compete in open, fair, and honest elections, if you don't have the guts to defend your ideas, and if you think the only way you can win an election is by suppressing the vote, get out of politics and get another job. And I really do. I mean that from the bottom of my heart. You know, everybody in politics, sometimes you win and sometimes you lose. You do well, you do your best, you try to convince people of your point of view. But the idea that we have people out there, governors, attorneys general, who are trying to make it harder. Did I strike a nerve here in Kansas? People who are trying to make it harder for poor people to vote, for young people to vote, for older people, to people of color. That is a disgrace. And any politician part of that process should be ashamed of himself or herself. Now I'd like to say a word to folks who are not in this room, Republicans who voted for Mr. Trump. Throughout his campaign for president, Donald Trump told the people of Kansas, people of Vermont, people of America, that he was a different kind of Republican. That's what he said. And he said, among many other things, he said that he would not cut Social Security, he would not cut Medicare, and he would not cut Medicaid. He said, and he ran very powerful, well-done political ads. I saw them at the end of the campaign, very strong ads, which said, I, Donald Trump, am on the side of the working class of this country, and I am going to take on the establishment. That's what he said. And there are people in Kansas, people in Vermont, and people all over this country who voted for him based on what he said he would do. Now, let me quote you so that there is no misunderstanding. Let me quote you. Now, you know, we have a government of tweets now. Let me quote you exactly. And now I speak to our Republican friends in the state. This is exactly word for word what Donald Trump said during his campaign. He said, quote, I was the first and only potential GOP candidate to state there will be no cuts to Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid. But the end of quote. But it wasn't just one tweet. In many ways, those promises were part of an essential part of what his campaign was about. On April 18, 2015, Trump said, and I quote, every Republican wants to do a big number on Social Security. They wanted to do it on Medicare. They want to do it on Medicaid. And we can't do that. And it's not fair to the people that have been paying in for years, and now all of a sudden, they want to be cut. End of quote. August 10, 2015, Trump said, quote, I will save Medicare, Medicaid, and Social Security without cuts. We have to do it. People have been paying in for years, and now many of these candidates want to cut it, end quote. March 29, 2016, Trump said, quote, you know, Paul Ryan wants to knock out Social Security, knock it down, way down. He wants to knock Medicare way down. And frankly, well, two things. Number one, you're going to lose the election if you're going to do that. I am not going to cut it, and I'm not going to raise ages, and I'm not going to do all of the things that they, Ryan and his friends, want to do. But they want to really cut it, and they want to cut it very substantially, the Republicans, and I'm not going to do that. And on and on and on. Those are promises that he made to the American people. And I've read you word for word of exactly what he said during the campaign. Well, a funny thing happened. He seems to have forgotten what he said during the campaign, and today his views are very different. After telling the American people that he would not cut Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid, what he did was nominate people for cabinet positions who have spent their entire careers advocating for the exact same cuts that Trump said he was not in favor of. Tom Price, the recently appointed Secretary of Health and Human Services, said, this is a knowledgeable audience. This is what Congressman Price said, quote, Nothing has had a greater negative effect on the delivery of health care than the federal government's intrusion into medicine through Medicare. We will not rest until we make certain that government-run health care is ended. End of quote. Mick Mulvaney, the new head of the Office of Management and Budget, OMB, has said, and I quote, "We have to end Medicare as we know it." And he also said, "Social Security is a Ponzi scheme." And then he said, "Medicare as it exists today is finished." Now, I say not just to the people here, but I say to our Republican friends all over the state who voted for Trump. Look, we may disagree on issues, but I hope we can at least agree that when a candidate makes promises, that candidate should keep those promises. So I say to Mr. Trump, and I say it tonight, and Trump and his friends kind of follow some of what I say, so I hope they're listening tonight. You know, Mr. President, you promised the people you would not cut Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid. So I urge you, send out one more tweet. And in that tweet, tell the American people that you're gonna keep your word, that you are not gonna cut Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid. Now, I would hope very much that President Trump will send that tweet out. But between you and me, I doubt very much that he will. I believe, and I say this without any joy in my heart, I believe that Trump never for one second believed what he was saying. But it's not only the promises that Trump made regarding Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid. You also may remember that during his campaign, candidate Trump had some very harsh words from Wall Street. He almost sounded like Bernie Sanders. He said that he was going to, quote, drain the swamp. Remember that? He said, and I quote, "I am not going to let Wall Street get away with murder. Wall Street has caused tremendous problems for us," end of quote. And at least in one of his TV ads, there was a head of one of the major Wall Street banks right there on TV to be demonized by Mr. Trump. Furthermore, not only did he tell us all that he was going to do about Wall Street, he actually put language into the Republican platform that would reinstate the Glass-Steagall Act of 1933, something which I have supported for years, Elizabeth Warren, other progressives have supported. Something that, in fact, is a very good idea. Well, guess what? Campaign came and the campaign is gone. And now Mr. Trump's kind of attitude toward Wall Street seems to have changed just a little bit. Instead of draining the swamp, he has brought the entire swamp right into his administration. Trump has more millionaires and billionaires in his cabinet than any president in American history, including at least a half a dozen executives from Goldman Sachs, one of the largest financial institutions in this country. An institution that, by the way, paid a $5 billion settlement fee to the federal government for illegal behavior. Now, Mr. Trump, in his rather unusual way to drain the swamp, has named as his chief economic advisor a gentleman named Gary Cohn.
Mr. Cohn is the former president of Goldman Sachs. And when we talk about greed and unethical behavior, when Mr. Cohn left Goldman Sachs, he received a modest severance package. And I look at workers today who don't have their pensions they were promised. He got a $285 million severance package from Goldman Sachs. During the campaign, and again, I speak to our Republican friends. During the campaign, Trump told the American people that he knew a lot about a broken tax system. And indeed, he did. He's a billionaire and doesn't pay any taxes. And he said, hey, I know all about that system. I was able to avoid taxes. So right now, what the Republicans are planning on as part of their tax reform are hundreds of billions of dollars in tax breaks for the wealthiest people in this country, including Mr. Trump, and for the largest corporations. What Mr. Trump has shown us is that he is not going to take on the establishment, but that his administration is the establishment. But it is not only that he lied to the American people over and over again. There is something else that he has done since he was elected and took office that I think is incredibly un-American. What every president, regardless of political view, tries to do is to bring us together as a nation. What Trump is trying to do is to divide us up. He is trying to have us turn upon each other. Please do not forget that before Trump got involved in the presidential campaign, he was a leader of the so-called Bertha movement, a racist effort to undermine the legitimacy of our first African-American president. Do not forget that Trump lied about seeing Muslim people on a rooftop in New Jersey celebrating the destruction of the Twin Towers. Turns out he was the only person in the world to have seen that television program. Do not forget that as of this week, he is trying to rescind an effort by the Obama administration to end discrimination against transgender kids. So what I say to President Trump is the people of America hold a very, very different vision of this country than you do. We as a nation have struggled and have had a very rocky road in fighting against racism, against sexism, against xenophobia, and against homophobia. And President Trump, we are not going back. We are not going back toward racism. After all of the struggles of the civil rights movement, we are not going back to making women second-class citizens. And after all of the prejudice that we as a nation have overcome against the Irish and the Italians and the Jewish people, we are not going back to xenophobia. We are not going to attack our Latino brothers and sisters. We as progressives have a very different vision than President Trump. Our vision says that in the wealthiest country in the history of the world, we're going to create a government that works for all of us, not just the 1%. And we are going to think big and create a nation in which every man, woman, and child has a decent, decent standard of living. We together are going to raise the minimum wage to a living wage, $15 an hour. Instead of forcing women to earn 79 cents on the dollar compared to men, we are going to pass legislation for pay equity. Equal pay for equal work. We are going to protect a woman's right to choose. And while we fight to protect the Affordable Care Act today, our vision is a Medicare for All single-payer program. It is not a radical idea, not a radical idea to suggest that the United States should join every other major country on earth and guarantee health care to all as a right, not a privilege. And unlike the president and his new EPA administrator, we know that climate change is not a hoax, but a threat, a terrible threat to this country and this world. We know that climate change is real, it is caused by human activity, and that we must transform our energy system away from fossil fuel to energy efficiency. And we know that in a highly competitive global economy, it is counterproductive for what this country is about and our future to have hundreds of thousands of young people, bright young people, not being able to afford to go to college and others leaving school deeply in debt. And I'm proud to say that the call we made here in Kansas and all over this country to make public colleges and universities tuition-free is catching on all around this country. And no, we do not support rounding up people who have lived in this country for 5 years, 10 years, 20 years. Destroying families, causing people enormous anxiety. Our job is comprehensive immigration reform and a path toward citizenship. And no, we are not going to allow Trump and his friends to cut Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid. Instead, I have just introduced legislation last week that does exactly what the American people want, and that is to expand benefits under Social Security. Let me conclude by saying this. I understand that in Vermont and here and all across this country, people are nervous and they are apprehensive, and you have reason to feel that way. But two things. Number one, nobody has the right to throw their hands up and say, I quit. I'm not going to be involved in the struggle. Despair is not an option. Number two, remember that Trump received, he lost the popular vote by almost 3 million votes. He has a mandate for nothing. And on every major issue, some of which I discussed here this evening, on every major issue, vast majority of the American people are on our side, not his side. The truth is that Donald Trump has changed the rules about political engagement. We have never had a president who is a pathological liar. We have never had a president who was so cynical about what he said during the campaign and what he did the day after he took office. And our job is to respond accordingly. We can defeat the Trump agenda. We can create a progressive America if millions of people stand up and fight back, and we are beginning to see that already. We're seeing it here at this incredible turnout. We saw it a month ago with the Women's March that brought out millions. We saw it today in 130 congressional offices. There were people outside those offices saying to their Republican members of Congress, have the guts to meet with us. Do not repeal the Affordable Care Act. So my message to you all is we are the majority, and our job, which is not an easy job, is to bring people together, to demand of your members of Congress, of your members of Senate, of your governor to start listening to the people. Listen to the people, not wealthy campaign contributors. And Kansas, I know that you are ground zero for trickle-down economics. And I look forward to working with you in the years to come. If you transform Kansas, as I know you can, we're going to transform this country. Thank you all very much.